the calm never lasts for long. Every 111 days, the shockwave is reignited and the violent cycle begins anew.
It's much stranger than anything that we have in our own solar system. If you were there, you would be incinerated immediately before you had a chance to really sort of groove on your surroundings.
The universe seems adept at creating strange worlds. Even in the most unlikely of places. This is a pulsar, a rapidly spinning variety of an exotic stellar object called a neutron star. Neutron stars are the remnants left behind after a massive star explodes in a supernova. No one expected to find planets circling in such a treacherous cosmic neighborhood.
Never in my wildest dreams did I think we would ever find planets orbiting a neutron star, a pulsar. I mean, after all, neutron stars are formed as a result of supernova explosions where the star just blows up. So certainly any planets that might have been there to begin with would have been blown away.
And yet, in the early 1990s, astronomers discovered two rocky planets around a pulsar 7,000 trillion miles from Earth. Their discovery, in fact, predates 51 Pegasi b, making them technically the first alien worlds ever detected. But since they orbit such strange stars, many astronomers consider pulsar planets to be in a category of their own.
The pulsar planets were very interesting. They're actually very low in mass and more similar to the Earth's mass. They form an interesting exotic classification or family of planets, but it's by no means the mainstream.
While most planets are believed to have formed out of the same disk of gas and dust as their parent stars, clearly these pulsar planets formed a different way.
The planets that have been found must have formed after the supernova explosion. And that's really bizarre because we would think that all of the material was blown away, but apparently some of that debris must have somehow been in a disk and parts of that disk coalesced into planets. But that's extremely surprising. I don't know that anyone really understands that process yet.
Although the pulsar planets are believed to have rocky surfaces, it's unlikely they would be a platform for life, and any visit by humans would be short-lived. As the pulsar rotates, it emits well-focused beams of charged particles from its poles, creating a rotating spotlight of horrific radiation.
Standing on a pulsar planet would be a very dangerous proposition. There would be high energy radiation all around you, just an onslaught of particles and waves. And the radiation field would be so strong that it would probably destroy your living tissue, and it would certainly cause cancer and mutations very quickly. But it would probably kill you. If you were really unlucky, or lucky, I suppose, if you're going to die anyway, you might as well die in a spectacular way, you would be in the beam of the pulsar. So every rotation, the beam would flash past you, and you would see this incredibly bright beacon, like a lighthouse really close to you, just flashing in your face. It would not be a very hospitable environment, no way.
While the pulsar planets might not be nice places to visit, they have taught us something fundamental about planet formation in the universe.
These planets, weird planets around a neutron star, have taught us that planetary formation appears to be relatively easy. Gravity appears to like to pull stuff together when there's enough stuff in a given region.
If nature is so good at making planets, even under difficult circumstances, then the odds are fairly high that the universe is full of planets, and that somewhere out there in the cosmos, other Earths are waiting to be discovered. But if that's the case, then where are the Earths? Why haven't we found them yet?
The first planets that were found in the late 1990s were massive planets, 300 times the mass of our Earth. And it's really not a surprise that we found the most massive ones first. Like the giant redwood trees behind me, they were the easiest to see from the enormous distances that we were looking. So when we find stars where we say, ah, there's just one single massive planet, one giant redwood, that's almost certain to not be true. There's almost certainly a forest of planets and asteroids and comets also orbiting that star.
As astronomers continue to scrutinize alien solar systems, they are edging ever closer to finding Earth-like planets. This is Gliese 436b. It's a world roughly 20 times the mass of Earth, similar in mass and size to Neptune. It orbits a star 30 light years away in the constellation Leo.
I'm so excited about Gliese 436, I'm almost jumping out of my clothes. It's the most important discovery since 51 Pegasi, maybe even more important.
What has Jeff Marcy so excited is that this planet was found to have a density of 2.1 grams per cubic centimeter.
What does that mean? It's a spectacular number, because every school child knows that the density of water is 1 gram per cubic centimeter. And we also know that rocks that you pick up on the street, the density of our Earth, for example, as a rock, is about 5 grams per cubic centimeter. And therefore, this planet around 436 is composed of a mixture of rock and water.
A planet made of rock and water sounds tantalizingly Earth-like, but Gliese 436b has so much water, there would be no land masses exposed at all. And you wouldn't want to take a swim in the oceans of this watery alien world. There may be a layer of liquid water on the surface, but below that, things begin to get a little weird.
There's so much water that the sheer gravitational force of the water molecules pressing down toward the center will crush the water so tightly that the water molecules are almost touching each other. It's a very odd type of water. In fact, we call it ice, even though it's not cold, because the water molecules will be arranged in a structure like ice, but only due to its high pressure.
Clearly, Gliese 436b isn't quite an Earth-like planet. But what about this alien world? What would make an alien planet truly Earth-like? It should be made primarily of rock, with enough water for oceans, but not so much water that the land masses are completely submerged. It would also have to be in its star's habitable zone.
The typical idea for a habitable zone is the range of distances from a star where an Earth-like planet could have liquid water at its surface. The idea would be that if you took Earth and pushed it in too far, the oceans would all boil away, and that's bad for life. Or if you took the Earth and pushed it out too far, the oceans would all freeze, and that's bad for life.
In our own solar system, the habitable zone ranges from Mars's orbit into as close as where Venus orbits. But the habitable zone in alien solar systems varies, depending on how hot the star is. Currently, our best hope for finding habitable Earth-like planets is to look around cool, dim stars called red dwarfs or M dwarfs.
The M dwarfs themselves are very special stars. So our sun might be a 100-watt light bulb. An M dwarf is perhaps a 10-watt light bulb. And so what that means is that to stay warm enough so that you have liquid water, not ice, but still not too hot, you move the planet in much closer. And those close planets are easier for us to detect with our technique because they tug on the star more.
One of these M dwarfs, called Gliese 876, has been found to have at least 3 planets orbiting it. 2 of them are gas giants, but the third, Gliese 876d, is one of the smallest planets discovered so far. at roughly 6 or 7 times the mass of the Earth. It's also just on the edge of its star's habitable zone.
The planet orbits in just 1.9 days around its host star, but because the host star is so low in luminosity, it puts it on the edge of what you might imagine the habitable zone to be. There could be some region, a ring around the planet towards the backside, where the temperature is actually just right for liquid water to exist.
When it was first discovered, scientists hailed this planet as the first of the super-Earths.
7 times the mass of the Earth sounds so close to the size of our Earth that you wonder whether or not it's a rocky planet, maybe with a thick atmosphere.
But today, the experts are unsure whether this is a large rocky planet at all. Like LISA 436b, it may be completely covered in an ocean of super dense water.
But to call it a super Earth is to suggest that we've found a planet that's a close cousin of our Earth. I would now rather think of it as a distant cousin, not unrelated to our Earth, but far enough away, indeed more like Neptune in our own solar system, that has a big rocky core, but surrounded by a big envelope of water.
So the race continues to discover the first truly Earth-like planet. At the University of Arizona, astronomer Laird Close is hoping to capture the first picture of an alien Earth. But to do that will take a giant leap in telescope technology. Here at the Steward Observatory Mirror Lab, in a cavernous space underneath the bleachers of the university's football stadium, engineers are working on the next generation of super telescopes.
This is the largest mirror that's ever been made. This mirror is 8.4 meters across, but it's just 1/7 of the size that's needed for the giant Magellan Telescope. And together, when combined with 7 other mirrors like it for the giant Magellan Telescope, we will be able to actually directly image extrasolar planets and maybe even Earth-like planets around alien suns.
Scheduled for completion in 2016, this telescope will be able to make images up to 10 times sharper than the Hubble Space Telescope. NASA and the European Space Agency are also developing several missions that will use space-based telescopes to search the stars for our planetary kin.
This will be incredibly exciting for humankind to know whether or not around those little points of light that we see in the night sky, whether there's Earth-like planets tied in orbit around those stars.
As technology improves, we're going to be able to find planets that look much more like the Earth, planets that perhaps have life on them, and maybe even planets that have forests and steam trains.
The astronomers who have dedicated their lives to this quest all believe it's only a matter of time before we find the first truly Earth-like planet.
The most exciting thing I can tell you is that we are now routinely discovering, commonly discovering, planets that are a mere 5 or 10 times the mass of our Earth. We're not quite to the point where we're finding Earths, and that's where we really want to be. But we're finding planets that are ever so close to our home planet.
So when we actually do cross that final threshold and do find evidence that there's a habitable planet out there, this is going to be quite an epical event for humanity.
People should not worry too much yet that we haven't found any Earth-like planets because, well, a lot of effort's going into it right now, and I think it will be done in the next 10 years. Yeah, stay tuned.